Hello, my name is Tom Schaeffer. I'm pastor of Faith United Lutheran Church in Toledo, Ohio. This is Pentecost Sunday. It is what we sometimes refer to as the birthday of the church. And we're going to talk about what the important purpose of the church is today. Thanks for joining us on Faith United Online. Our reading today is from Acts chapter 2, verses 1 through 21. It's known as the story of Pentecost. It begins like this. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place. And suddenly from heaven there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues as of fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. Now there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem. And at this sound, the crowd gathered and was bewildered, because each one heard them speaking in the native language of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked, "Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear each of us in our own native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia, Pamphylia, Egypt, and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs, in our own language, we hear them speaking about God's deeds of power." All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, "What does this mean?" But others sneered and said, "They are filled with new wine." But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed to them, "Men of Judea and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk as you suppose, for it is only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. In the last days it will be, God declares, that I will pour out my Spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even upon my slaves, both men and women, in these days I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show portents in the heaven above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and smoky mist. The sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. From the time of being a young man, I desired to be a part of a movement of God, a revival. I decided to enter ministry when I was in the ninth grade, and even then it was much to the surprise of no one that I made that decision. And that is something I've longed to see in my life, in my ministry, in this world, is revival. Ken Hunter, a dear friend of mine and the founder of Church Doctor Ministries, a consulting ministry for churches that has worked with churches around the world, has been praying for revival to happen here in the United States for over 40 years. Now, what does this mean? What is revival? It's a strange word, a word that's kind of uncommon to us. Some think, when they hear of the word revival, maybe you think this, of slick television evangelists. That is not what revival is. Some think it's a new style of worship or a program. Well, revival isn't any of those things either, because revival isn't something we do. Revival is something that the Holy Spirit does in and through us. The Princeton Dictionary defines revival as bringing again into activity and prominence. Revival, from the biblical standpoint, from God's standpoint, is God's reanimation of his church in order to bring his kingdom into activity and prominence. Ezekiel in the Old Testament tells us a story of revival and what revival is. Revival is what happens when the Holy Spirit breathes new life into old bones. And I believe that God wants to breathe new life into the old bones of church in our society and world today. And what does that mean for us? Well, it's not comfortable church. It's not a provider-consumer mentality, which we operate with in, you know, many of our churches, where it is simply, I tune in, and you feed me. I'm going to consume what you give me. But let me share with you what God wants from you. God wants his church to be a place of an investor-producer relationship, where God, the Holy Spirit, is the investor. He invests you with his power. He fills you with his Holy Spirit. And with that, we can produce the will and work of God. We can produce the fruits of the Spirit. We can produce for the kingdom. It's an investor-producer relationship. You see, God isn't all that interested in keeping us comfortable in the church. He is interested in nourishing and equipping you to be a part of a kingdom movement so much bigger than you or me. So how do we become part of God's revival? From the very beginning of the church, God shows us how. So let's look at the birthday of the church, the day of Pentecost. And I want you to notice something at the beginning of our reading concerning what the apostles did to bring on the very first revival in Christianity. What did they do? Nothing. Well, not quite. But before stating the one thing they did, let's talk about what they did not do, what they did not have, what they didn't use to cause this revival. They did not have a superior understanding of God's plan. They didn't really understand the Bible all that well. They didn't understand Jesus' mission all that well. Back in Acts chapter 1, we see this time when the disciples are gathered, and they have seen at this point, think about this, the disciples have seen the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. They've experienced all of that. And they're about to witness his ascension. And Jesus, even now, is with them at this point, and he is teaching them. He says to them in Acts chapter 1, verses 3 through 5, it says there, he appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. On one occasion, while he was eating with them, he gave them this command: do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. And after experiencing all of this, the ministry of Jesus, the death and resurrection of Jesus, Jesus now sitting with them after being resurrected and about to be ascended into heaven, what do they ask? They ask this, they say, Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel? You see, they're still thinking about the old ways. And isn't that just like what often happens in the church, what happens with Christians? You know, God wants to show us a new thing, and the church is asking, when will you restore the good old days? When are you bringing that back, Jesus? They don't understand. The second thing is, they don't have a lot of courage. In the Gospel of John, we're told that they were often huddled together for fear of the Jews. They were afraid of the outside word. And isn't that just like the church? Afraid to go out into the world, afraid to share our faith. And so we just stay huddled together in our church groups where it's safe. There is one thing that the apostles did do. They acted with obedience. We've talked about this before, revival and obedience. Back when several weeks ago, we heard the story of Stephen from Acts chapter 6 and 7. But it's such an important lesson that we're coming back to it today, because really it is what the book of Acts is about. It is about the revival, this birth of the church, this Holy Spirit-driven growth of the church. And the apostles who were part of that, the Acts of the Apostles. And what was the act of the apostle? It was their obedience. And so we see that here again, they acted with obedience. In Luke chapter 24, we're told, Jesus says, I am going to send you what my Father has promised, but stay in the city until you've been clothed with power from on high. Then in Acts chapter 1, they're told, do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you've heard me speak about. He tells them, only then should they act. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. The only act necessary for revival is obedience to the mission of God. It is our obedience that allows the Holy Spirit to work in and through us. Apart from the Holy Spirit, we can do nothing. You can try. We can try in the church to do things our way, but would you rather experience the results that you can produce or the results God can produce when he invests his power in you? Would you rather see what you can do or would you rather see what the Holy Spirit can do through you? So what is the effect of this obedience? God immediately moves them outside of their holy huddles to be his witnesses out in the world. And what is the response of the people when they experience this power of God? Well, they're curious, they're amazed, they're confused, and yes, some are negative. Some, however, it says in our scriptures, verse 13, made fun of them and said, they have had too much wine. But most listen. And Peter preaches. 3,000 are baptized that day. Can the disciples take the credit? No. How about Peter? Was he a world-class communicator? No. He was a fisherman. He could probably swear more colorfully than he could preach. This could only be God, only be the Holy Spirit. That's the way it is with revival. So what is the response? What do you need to do to be a part of God's plan for revival today? Be obedient. Be attentive. Learn to listen. Grow as a disciple. Grow as one who learns to learn from Jesus. Learn to identify the moments when God is giving you the opportunity to do his will, and then do what Jesus has called you to do. You will be my witnesses to the ends of the earth. And for those that are listening, that are not yet on that journey of discipleship, our story today also gives you a powerful thing to respond to. At the very end of our reading, it says, then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. If you're listening and you're like, well, look, I respond in obedience. I don't even know that I believe yet. I don't even know that I have faith yet. Then hear those words and join us on this incredible adventure of experiencing what God can do through you. Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Why don't you call on him today? Thanks for joining us today for this message about revival and obedience, what it is to be the church, what the purpose of the church is, and also that important message of how does one become part of the church, which is really to say, how does one become a disciple? How does one come to know that they are saved through the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ? And as our story today from Acts chapter 2 tells us, call on the name of the Lord, because everyone who does so will be saved. Thanks for joining us this week. God bless you. Keep safe. Take care.